Hello everyone, I want to welcome each one of you to our lecture 3 in business environment. The last time that I presented, we were discussing the types of business organizations, and today we are now moving on to aspects of the environment. Okay, I will start by understanding the meaning of the environment. But let me start by just presenting a diagram. And this diagram gives us all the major components of the environment. Okay, and this is a diagram. And I believe all of us have seen this diagram. We have this diagram in our notes, and I encourage you to make references to it just in case some of the text is not very visible. So this diagram presents three levels of the environment. On the far right there, we have what we call the internal environment, and then we have the external environment that is broken into two levels. So the environment we are discussing here in terms of business, we look at those two broad categories. The external environment, where we have the macro environment or the general environment, and then we have another level called the micro environment or the task environment. And then in the internal environment, we have all the factors or elements that we find in an organization. And this is what we are going to deal with for the next two lectures. And then the last lecture, we'll be able to discuss issues of ethics and corporate social responsibility. So quickly, let me start by addressing the external environment, where we have those two levels. So what's the meaning of the external environment? Now, the external environment of any business organization refers to all the factors, all the elements that are outside an organization, and these factors or elements can actually affect an organization in a positive way or in a negative way. Okay? So, and this element, this level of the environment has got two layers. But before we get to the two levels of the environment, I want to emphasize this from the web-go. As we try to understand the business environment, our interest as business managers is to understand how changes in that environment affect a business. You may have changes in some of the environmental elements. You may have some pressure coming from the environment. You may have some forces coming from the environment. And our interest as business managers is to understand how businesses get impacted and how do we manage those environmental elements. That is our interest. It's not enough just to identify these elements. The focus, even in terms of exams, in terms of answering your questions, you'll be asked to explain how those environmental elements affect businesses. So there are two levels. Number one, like I mentioned earlier, we have what we call the general environment. The general environment, in other words, is referred to as the macro environment. Now, this is the broader environment away from an organization. And in this environment, we have all those factors that are not specific to one particular organization. That's why it is called the general environment. So we have non-specific dimensions and the forces, and these surround an organization and they affect an organization in one way or another. And simply put, we are referring to all the best factors that we get out there, and we'll be able to explain what each one of those entails. Now, that is the broader environment, the macro environment. The next level of the environment is what we call the task environment. In other books, it is referred to as the micro environment or the operating environment. Others still will say the immediate environment. So you must be familiar with all those synonyms or terms that will just bring out the same meaning. So it is the task environment or the micro environment, the immediate environment, or the operating environment. Now, at that level of the environment, we get most of the key stakeholders, organizations or individuals or firms that may be closer to a business. These may be specific to a particular organization, or we're even referring to things like your competitors, your customers, the community you're operating in. So in simple terms, we are basically referring to key stakeholders that may have an interest in the business and that may affect the running of your business. So in terms of the external environment, we get those two levels, the general environment and the task environment. So let's quickly get to the general environment and understand the elements under the general environment. And that's where I'm going to focus my presentation today. The next presentation, we'll move on to the task environment. And as we analyze the general environment, we'll be guided by the PESTEL framework. Remember in the first lecture, when we are trying to understand the overview of this course, I emphasized the fact that business environment, to a very large extent, requires you to understand the PESTEL framework or model, because it is a model that is used to analyze the broader environment. And in this presentation, we'll do a quick run through of the political environment, the economic environment, the social environment, and the technological environment. And I want to encourage you, as you read, as you study, go to the textbooks, you'll get a lot of illustrations and cases on each one of these, elements of the PESTEL framework and how they impact business organizations. So I'll start with the political environment, and I'm combining political and the legal because they are very closely related. So when you talk of the political environment, we are basically referring to the understanding of some of the laws, interpretation of the laws that require firms to comply with. That's why I've brought in the legal environment as well. Because in terms of government, from our knowledge in our civic education, when we talk of the arms of governance, we have three. We have the legislature, we have the judiciary, and we have the executive. So when our MPs go parliament and they sit there, they debate laws, those are the ones that determine some of these laws, and they pass them, and they tend to affect our businesses. So it's coming from that perspective that, yes, the political environment may also combine very well with the legal environment, because this requires us as business managers, business owners, to understand some of these laws and how they affect business organizations, because we have to comply. Now, when it comes to some of these laws, you can't show ignorance that, no, I don't know. Ignorance or non-compliance may actually result in fines. You may lose out big time. We have seen a lot of businesses that have lost huge sums of money because of just a bit of negligence. We have seen in the recent past in Zanta here, the Minister of Labor and Social Services is all over pouncing on business organizations that are failing to observe some of the labor laws. And this is a hot issue now. So as business managers, we must understand some of these laws and how they affect business. So you don't have to show ignorance, or well, just choose not to do that which you are expected to do. So how do we proceed then? We must operate within the legal framework. Now, doing business requires you to understand the fact that it is conducted, business activities are conducted within the legal framework. For example, there are laws that protect employees, like I just mentioned. There are laws that protect your own customers. That's why most companies have come up with agencies, commissions, that deal with consumer protection. In the case of Zambia, we have our own CCPC, Competition and Consumer Protection Commission. So you cannot just, you know, disadvantage a customer. They are protected. There are laws that deal with, for example, fair trading. There are laws that deal with competition. So what you need to do as a business manager is to make sure that you are operating within the legal framework. That way you are being socially responsible and ethical in the way that you conduct your business. So still on the political and the legal environment, we must also understand that politics is a universal activity that affects the business world in various ways. And you may be wondering, we are doing business environment. Do we see a correlation between politics and business? And in most cases, we don't want to have anything to do with politics. People say it's a dirty game. But we must understand that politics, these political activities, affect businesses in several ways. And I'll just mention a few of those. So many political and legal forces directly influence the way organizations operate. Like I mentioned earlier, it is the politicians, when they meet in parliament, they enact those pieces of legislation that come up with those laws that affect businesses. Even things like the minimum wage, it will take the politicians to go to parliament, agree, and then that will be effective. So businesses get affected anyway. Now, your role as a person, a business manager, a student, a business owner who is interested in business, your role is to understand these political systems, understand political institutions, understand political processes. A good understanding of the political environment will help you in two ways. Number one, you get a greater insight into business decisions. You know then how you're going to make your decisions in business because you're familiar with the political environment. It also helps you to understand how complex this environment is in which you're operating. So let's not just forget about the political environment. It's critical. You really have to understand. It will help you in making your business decisions. Now, the political environment has got both international dimensions and the domestic dimensions. So when you're operating in Zambia, your business is just in Zambia, of course your interest is to understand the political environment in Zambia. The moment you decide to go beyond the national boundaries, you want to have a business operate, say, in South Africa, a business operate in Namibia, the business environment changes altogether. And that's why we have what we call international forces, because the cultural setup there will be different, the tax system will be different, the labor laws will be different. So the political environment, political and legal environment will have these dimensions. And that has come in due to the increase of globalization. There's a lot of international trade now taking place. Most businesses want to go beyond the national boundaries. We have seen how some businesses struggle. Foreign investors that come in, the moment they fail to observe certain laws, the moment they fail to understand the political environment, processes, and institutions, they find it very difficult to do business. So that is very key. Still on the political legal environment, we must also be aware of these laws. There are some laws that are state laws, others are local laws, and how they influence our activities. We have central government, we have local government. You may have a business that is operating in a local area and there are municipalities there. You are expected to get things like the trading licenses from the councils. If you are not renewing those and you are not working within the confines of the laws, you may actually have challenges like I mentioned earlier. So some laws are state laws, others are local laws. Another example I can give here, you may be doing business in the rural setup of the country, and most of the land in the rural setups there is still under customary law, traditional land. So the chiefs have got a lot of power over that land, okay, and they are the ones who are in charge. So we find most businesses, when they go set up their operations in such areas, you must observe some of these local laws because they may have an influence on your business. Now, because most businesses have a challenge, they have problems in terms of compliance. Remember, we talked about compliance and ignorance, that when you do this, you're actually attracting fines, your business will be charged. What most governments do is that they establish what we call regulatory, you know, agencies to enforce the laws for purposes of enforcement. In Zambia, we have agencies like RATSA, agencies like CCPC, ZICTA, if you are in the telecommunications industry. All those regulatory agencies just help to enforce these laws and ensure that businesses are conducted within the legal framework. So if you're in the transport industry, passenger transport, you have a fleet of buses, then just know RATSA is there. So you must understand what RATSA expects you to do as a regulatory agency, because that sector is actually regulated by RATSA. You must ensure that your vehicles are roadworthy, your vehicles have road taxes and all those things. So it's important to understand the role of these regulators. Then, to end on the political environment, we have what we call political systems. Political systems. Now, politics is concerned with those processes which help to determine how conflicts are settled, how conflicts are contained and modified or even postponed. Now, government normally has a process. Government is concerned with power, the pursuit of power as they make their decisions. Okay, and these decisions that government made would have an effect on the lives of many people at local level, national level, even international level. That's why we have to be concerned with the political environment, because we have government there, and the government of the day will make these decisions that will affect each one of us at whatever level. Now, when we talk of a political system, we have two extremes in terms of political systems. We have a political system we call an authoritarian type of a political system and democratic type of a political system. A system is just the way things are done. So in terms of governance, there are some governments where there's dictatorship, other governments, there's democracy. Depending on the political system that has been adopted, that will actually have an influence on the type of the business. So authoritarian system, this one will try to settle any conflicts, if there are conflicts, misunderstandings, through the establishment of through the enforcement of rules, regulations, and orders that are established by the authorities in that particular government. So where there's authoritarian, rules will come in, orders will come in, established by the authority. That authority may be an individual, like a king, it may be a group of people, like a political party, or a military regime, and they normally assume that power, political power, in a variety of ways, like through an election, or it may be a coup, okay? So we must understand that there are all these ways that these groups may have the authority. Now, once these individuals or groups of people are in power, they will limit the degree of participation, of course, by others in terms of decision making. They will monopolize most of the processes, and they will just not permit any opposition altogether. That is authoritarian. So you have this government that has got a lot of dictatorial tendencies. they are silencing any opposing views. And every country will adopt any of this. So this society is often described as being totalitarian. You are using authority, you are using dictatorship, and you are the ones that are making the rules. You are discouraging or preventing participation. There's no opposition. So when you're doing business, it's important to understand the political environment. Are we operating under a political system that is dictatorial, or where they use, you know, an authoritarian political system, or is it democratic? The second one is democratic political systems. Now here, the assumption is that whenever there are conflicts, misunderstandings, parties must agree. You must come together, agree, and move in one direction. There must be some engagement of some kind. There must be rational discussions between the parties that are involved. So we see participation coming in, which is different from the other one. So conflict resolution is achieved through a system of political representation and responsibility. So if there are several parties, they must be represented, you must all come together, agree, and move in one direction. So in this system, the wishes and views of individuals are said to be represented by an established authority called the government. So the government will try to make sure that whatever they are doing those things in the interest of the members, the citizenry, the people out there, because these are the people that put you in authority. So government will be accountable to the people. They will be accountable at regular intervals. They come up with systems, mechanisms that bring in that accountability. Things like there will be an election. You are not just there forever. So you serve a term, and then when your term ends as a government, you conduct elections which must be free and fair to represent the wishes of the people. Now, why are we touching these things? We are doing business. Why do you get concerned with either dictatorship or democracy? These systems affect businesses because governments will make certain decisions. If, say, for example, you are doing business under a democratic political system, the chances are very high that the government will be engaging you in the way that they make decisions. Before they come up with any laws, they will engage you maybe as a business community because it is democratic. You are operating under an authoritarian political system, then you know here there will be a lot of dictatorial tendencies. Government will just make orders, use rules or laws to enforce whatever they want, and you have no participation whatsoever. So that analysis of the political environment is very important. So in our framework, the next one is the economic environment. So in business environment, you are not only concerned with the political environment. There is what we call the economic environment. Now, under the economic environment, we have these forces that affect both organizations and customers in terms of their decisions and activities. And that's why the economic environment is very critical, because any pressure, any force that will come from this environment will not only affect business organizations, but you and me as customers will also get affected in terms of our decisions and activities. The second point that I want us to note on the economic environment is that the overall state of the economy in all countries the world over fluctuates. So there are fluctuations in the state of the economy, and this creates what we call business cycles. When I was going through the syllabus, I explained that we have business cycles. You can have a boom, you can have a downturn, a recession, and then you start recovering. So these economic fluctuations, that we see, or business cycles that come as a result of the economy fluctuating. The next point is to take note on the economic environment, as you analyze the economic environment, is to appreciate the fact that the health of the economy will influence how much consumers spend and what they buy. Obviously, when the economy is doing well, we expect a lot of people to have money, disposable income, and because they have got money, that will influence what they buy and how much they spend. So in your analysis of the environment also, understand the health of the economy. Where is our economy today? So when we have rising inflation rates, rising interest rates, you know that people will be affected in one way or another. So therefore, the present day economic conditions and changes in the economy have a broad impact on the future success of the business. And that's why you need to get concerned with the economic environment. The conditions of the economy present will have a huge impact on the success of an organization. So I want us to really just give examples of some economic variables and how our consumption patterns are affected by some of these economic forces as customers. For example, it's important as a business person to understand that we are working with the rate of inflation. Okay, the rate at which prices of goods and services are changing. Okay, if your rate of inflation is very high, that simply tells that there's no price stability. And where there's no price stability, your planning in terms of business, you are affected because prices keep changing. Today you buy your inputs at 10 kwacha per kg, 3 months later it's no longer 10 kwacha, it has gone up to 15 kwacha. So that starts affecting your planning because you keep adjusting your prices if you have to stay in business and make the same profits that you're making. So the rate of inflation is one critical variable in the economic environment. Interest rates also, very important. The cost of borrowing, if banks are charging a lot of interest, many people want to be encouraged to go to the bank and get a loan for expanding your business because the interest rate is very high. So if the interest rates are high, that will discourage borrowing. When the interest rates are low, many people will be encouraged to borrow, and that will stimulate a lot of economic activity. So it's important to understand also how these affect businesses. The availability of credit for consumer purchases and or investment purposes. If credit facilities are readily available, then people will actually borrow whenever they want to buy certain, you know, household goods that require a lot of money, or where you just want to invest, you want to build a house or whatever. So credit facilities also very critical in an economy. You really have to understand if that is available. The other one is the rate of unemployment. Okay, the rate of unemployment. Later on in your course, when you do macroeconomics, you will be discussing issues of unemployment. Because if you are doing business, you are operating in an area where the rate of unemployment is very high, then the chances are that you may not sell a lot of your products because many people don't have money. Many people don't have money, they can't afford, they can't buy. Okay, so unemployment is another critical economic variable that we consider as we analyze the economic environment. We are also discussing the size of the disposable personal income. If people have got more money in their pockets, they will spend, the propensity to spend will be very high because they've got money, they can afford, so there will be effective demand for goods and services that you're operating, that you're offering. But if the disposable income is low, people will probably just spend on basic products. So if you're in a business where you're producing luxury products, you may not actually cash in a lot. I've visited some places in Zambia where certain businesses have just closed. And one of the reasons they give, like retail businesses, they'll tell you that many people in this area are not working. Their employment is very high, they don't have disposable income, so we are not selling. But for those businesses that may be offering basic products, maybe products like food products, that have everything to do with our survival, to meet the physiological needs, those businesses may survive. So it's important to understand these economic variables and how they get to affect your business. So if you are asked a question to analyze the economic environment and explain how the economic environment affects businesses, you have to give some of these examples and demonstrate how businesses get affected, for example, by changes in the rate of inflation, by changes in the exchange rate, by changes in the availability of credit, or maybe where there's a lot of unemployment, how do businesses get affected? That is very important to observe. Still on the economic environment, we have another concept, another aspect of the economic environment where we try to understand economic systems. Now, what is an economic system? An economic system just describes how a country's economy is organized. Every economy will have an economic system. Just like we are discussing the political systems, but we also have what we call economic systems. So this just describes how the economy of a particular country is organized. Now, why an economic system? Because we have a problem of scarcity. We have a problem of scarcity. Resources are very limited, so every country must determine, come up with a system of how they are going to use productive resources. You want to turn most of the resources in areas that will be more economical. Now, any economic system must answer three basic questions. There are three basic questions that any economic system must answer. Number one is what to produce. I'm sure this one is very familiar for those that are doing principles of economics. What to produce and how to produce, you must answer that question, and for whom to produce. So every government must answer those questions as they determine an economic system. So the way a society answers these questions will determine an economic system. So who makes decisions on what to produce? Who makes decisions on how goods and services are going to produce? The way you answer these three basic questions determine an economic system. So there are four types of economic systems. We have what we call, number one, a traditional economy, where economic decisions are based on customs and beliefs. So it's an economic system where whatever economic decisions that are made with regard to those three questions, what to produce, how to produce, and for whom to produce, under this economic system, those decisions will be based on customs and beliefs. Then we have what we call a command economy. Others will call it a centrally planned economy. This is where government makes all economic decisions, and most of the properties will be owned by the government. So under that system, the government decides what to produce, the government decides how to produce, and for whom they will produce those goods and services. Then the third type is the free market economy, where economic decisions are guided by changes in prices due to market forces of demand and supply. Again, under that economic system, decisions with regard to what to produce will be influenced by changes in prices and demand and supply. When there's demand for a particular product, most firms will be interested in producing such a product. And all the other two questions are guided, answers are provided by decisions that are guided by changes in price due to market forces. Then we have a mixed economy where businesses are owned most businesses who own the resources, the properties, but government will come in to regulate certain sensitive industries or sectors. Like in Zambia, we have adopted a mixed economy. There are certain sectors that are controlled by the government. The government will have a lot of control. Other sectors, the private individuals will come in and decide what they want to produce and how they want those things produced. So these are the four types. You have detailed notes in your slides and the web document, so I will encourage you to make references to that. The third one, before we get to the last one, is the social and cultural environment. So in business, again, you don't just get interested in the political environment and the economic environment. We also have what we call the social and cultural environment. Now, this analysis of the social and cultural environment is concerned with understanding the potential impact of society and the social changes on a business. We have what we call social changes. When we are experiencing these social changes, or when society is changing, businesses get affected. And we are going to briefly talk about those. So we may have changes like changes in tastes, changes in fashion, changes in lifestyle, in preferences. All these changes affect businesses big time. Okay? For example, today, because of health reasons, talking about tests, in the food industry, many people now want to eat traditional foods. Many people now are reducing on the consumption of these fast foods, even in terms of drinks, carbonated drinks. Many people now are reducing on those because of high levels of sugar. So those changes affect businesses that are in that industry. Then fashion also is changing. We have seen a lot of changes in terms of fashion, and if you are in that industry and you are saving maybe the yachts, you must make sure that you bring in fashion that is trending, or else you lose out in terms of your sales. Okay, so those are some of the examples that we can give on these social changes. Now let me end on the effects of the social environment on business. I'll just give a few examples, and then we'll pick it up from there. Changes in beliefs and values towards energy conservation, for example, have created a change in consumer preference away from vehicles that have got big engines. People now want to get vehicles that have got smaller engines because we want to save on your gas. And we have seen many automobile companies going in the production of these vehicles that are more efficient in terms of fuel because of that change or value towards energy conservation. You want to conserve energy. You don't want to use more energy. So there's a preference now away from gas-guzzling SUVs to hybrid sedans, these small cars. Some cultures treat the main meal as a social event, and any fast food won't just cut it. In our context in Zambia, people still go for shawarma as the main meal. So if you are a restaurant and you are offering such foods, if you just offer fast foods, you may not actually cash in. Social preferences relating to fashion are changing, and then there are also changes in lifestyle and eating health. Many people want to maintain small bodies. They want to exercise every day. We have seen a lot of businesses come up providing such fitness centers or the gym. Because of this change in terms of lifestyle, people want to eat out over the weekends. So we have a lot of these nice places that have come up because of that lifestyle. In the past, people would just eat from their homes. So So changes in lifestyle are creating a lot of business opportunities, and it's very important to analyze some of those. Okay, so we'll pick it up from there. I'll end here for today, and I'll encourage you to get well and be able to get more material. Thank you for your attention.